The gospel for this morning is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." The Lord replied, "If you had a faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to the mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it will obey you. Who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, 'Prepare for me, put on your apron, and serve me while I eat and drink. Later, you may eat and drink.' Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were ordered to do, say, 'We are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done.'" This is the gospel of the Lord. Thank you to God. Now please be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace and peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father, and our Lord and Brother, Jesus the Christ. In today's gospel lesson, Jesus tells about a small farmer who has only one slave working for him. This slave has to cook for his master in the evening after a day's back-breaking work. The slave waits until his master has finished his meal before he himself can eat. Then Jesus asks the audience, "Would a slave owner thank his slave?" No, a slave has no right to expect a thank you from his master. And Jesus uses this master-slave relationship to teach about discipleship. Disciples of Jesus belong exclusively to Jesus like slaves belonging to their master. The disciples are to serve and obey their master Jesus just as a slave is to serve and obey his master unconditionally. Wait a minute, some of you may protest. You know, slavery is an evil and inhuman institution. Christian church and Christians had fought hard in the church history to abolish all forms of slavery around the world. And we are to continue to fight to end modern slavery, such as human trafficking. How come? How come Jesus uses the imagery of slavery to talk about the discipleship? I want to let you know that I also wrestle with the imagery of a slave and a master relationship in the Bible. So, in the next 10 or 15 minutes, I'd like to invite you to look at several images of a slave in other parts of the Gospel and the New Testament, so that we can better understand why Jesus uses this imagery and what it means to us today. But first, I want you to, you know, look at with me at the parable of the talents, which is found in Matthew 25. Jesus says, "A certain master entrusts different amounts of money to the care of his three slaves. Two of them creatively, diligently, faithfully invest the money and doubled their investments. The master is pleased with the results and says to each of the two faithful and competent slaves, 'Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.'" You see, the master in this parable, in Matthew 25, you know, not only praises and rewards his true, trustworthy, and competent slaves, but also invites them to share his joy. This master treats his true, faithful, trustworthy slaves more like business associates than personal property. This master is a much more humane person, not a cruel and heartless taskmaster. Now let's look at another parable of Jesus, which is found in Luke chapter 12. It also involves the imagery of the slave and the master relationship. In Luke 12, Jesus asks his disciples to be alert and ready for action. Be like the slaves who are waiting for their master to return from a wedding banquet. Then Jesus says, Blessed are these slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat. He will come and serve them. But the master will put on his apron and serve his slaves. Unheard of, unimaginable. What's going on here? The roles of master and the slaves were completely reversed. How could that be? Something revolutionary happened in that parable in Luke chapter 12. In that parable, Jesus has in his mind a different kind of man about his identity and his mission. In Mark chapter 10, Matthew 20, Luke 22, Jesus says, whoever wants to be great must become a servant. And whoever wants to be first among you must be your slave. This is what the Son of Man has done. He came to serve, not to be his life, his ministry, his death, and his resurrection represented and modeled a different kind of master, a different kind of lordship. Jesus practiced what he preached. Before he was arrested and crucified, Jesus washed his disciples' feet, which was a lowly, menial task that only slaves did. As in the Last Supper, Jesus took the bread, broke it, saying, this is my body given for you, this is my blood shed for you. The deep spiritual meaning of the Lord's Supper is that Jesus, the Lord and the Master, sacrificed his life for the sake of humanity. Apostle Paul, in his letter to Philippians, says, Jesus, who has equal status with God, emptied himself, took on the status of a slave, and lived a selfless, obedient life, and then died a selfless, obedient life on the cross. So now let's get back to today's parable of Jesus in Luke chapter 16. You know, Jesus uses the master-slave imagery in his teaching because Jesus subverts the conventional idea of what a slave and a master relationship looks like in his day. Jesus demands total obedience from his disciples because Jesus himself became the obedient slave of God, sacrificing his life for the healing and salvation of humanity. Jesus' disciples are to follow our Master Jesus and live as our Lord and Master Jesus lived, not to dominate, to exploit, to enslave, to oppress others, but to serve and to love others. to love our neighbors as ourselves, as Jesus taught. Apostle Paul himself says he was a slave of Jesus. Okay, that's in the Bible. Romans chapter 1, verse 1. Apostle Paul says he is a slave of Jesus. And in Galatians chapter 2, Apostle Paul says, it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And in the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. You and I may wonder, how could Paul completely surrender his life to Jesus, like a slave surrendering his life to the master? How could Paul live completely for, in, and through Jesus? The answer Paul gave us is this. Jesus loved him and gave his life for him. Do you get it? Don't you see? Jesus' unconditional and sacrificial love for Paul is the very reason for Paul's complete obedience and allegiance to Jesus. Paul became a slave of Jesus. That had real-life implications for him. Paul famously said that in Christ's family, there should be no division into Jews and the Gentiles, slaves and the free, male and the female. All Christians are equal because of a common relationship with our Master, Jesus Christ. That's Paul's radical idea of equality of all believers. If we follow Jesus, do we treat others the way Jesus treats us? Think about that. If we believe that, do we believe that all lives matter, all lives have equal value in the eyes of Jesus? Philemon was a friend of Paul. Philemon's slave Onesimus ran away from his master and came to Paul. Apostle Paul, who was then in prison, accepted Onesimus and taught Onesimus' Christian faith. And then Paul sent Onesimus back to his master Philemon. And Paul wrote a letter to Philemon, said to Philemon, you are getting him back now for good, and no mere slave this time, but a true Christian brother. According to Paul, if anyone is a follower or is a slave of Jesus, then he or she cannot treat another human being as a slave. Paul's faith in his Master and the Lord Jesus changed the direction of his life and how he treated others, especially those who were at the bottom of the society in the first century Roman Empire. How about us? How does our faith in Jesus change the gospel? The apostles asked Jesus to increase their faith. In response to the apostles' request, Jesus says, if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. You see, what is faith? Faith is not something we can measure. Faith is a dynamic relationship between us and God, between us and our Master and the Lord Jesus. Jesus says, when we have faith in God, however imperfect or small our faith may seem, what God will do for us is infinitely more than what we dare to imagine or ask. Infinitely more than what we can offer to God. Compared to what God has and will do for us, what we can offer to God is worthless. No one can outdo God's generosity and God's faithfulness. And certainly, no one can outgive God. So let's ask ourselves, what is the motivation of a Christian obedience to God and to our Lord and Master Jesus? Our motivation is purely God's unbounded love and the generosity for us, which is revealed to us in the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and nothing else. Are we willing to put our life on the line, obeying and follow Jesus? We obey and follow Jesus, not because Jesus is a harsh taskmaster, but because Jesus has my best interest and your best interest in his heart. Because obeying and following Jesus leads to truly abundant life, leads to true spiritual freedom. Freedom from the bondage of sin, of selfishness and self-centeredness. And the freedom to love God with our whole heart and mind and soul, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. So, let's get one thing perfectly clear. Obedience to Jesus leads to true freedom. Giving our life to Jesus leads to truly abundant and fulfilling life. This is the second Sunday of our fall giving appeal. And you receive this bulletin insert today. We are asked to come before God and to pray about our offering of our time, our talents, and our treasure to God's kingdom work in the church and through the church. As we pray about what and how much you can offer to Christ's church, think about what God has done and will do for you. Think about what kind of a person Jesus wants me to become. Think about the kind of life Jesus wants you and all of us to have. And think about Jesus' words in today's gospel lesson. If you had a faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you. In Jesus' name,